Hello, everyone. Welcome to the living room. We're back. Another week of Bible discussion, Bible study. Love doing this with Mike, and I pray that you love doing it with us. Here's your couch. Here's our time. Here's the word. And Mike's going to pray for us as we get started. So I also pray that you would be praying that God would open our hearts and minds to the truth of what we're going to be talking about today. Anyway, Mike?
Thanks, Joe. It's great to be able to do this with you guys. It's interesting because this is something Joe and I do all the time. So when we'll be in a meeting and we'll be talking about scripture and things of God, and now we just we get to do this and share this with you guys. So it's real exciting for us to share our heart for scripture, our heart for God, with you guys on a weekly basis. This is something we're going to continue to do, and we hope you guys enjoy it as much as we do. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for this opportunity to come together and dig deep into your word and discuss, what we're going to be doing today, which is, discussing the resurrection and Jesus starting to appear to his disciples. God, thank you for that opportunity, for overcoming the grave. You defeated sin on the cross, and you defeated the grave through your resurrection. God, thank you for that. Thank you for thinking so much of us to bring us fully to you, into fellowship with you, God. Please bless our time together. God, we pray for our congregation here at First Baptist. We pray for their health. We pray for their, any trials or tribulations they have going on through this season. God, just be with them. Encourage them to get to know you better during this season. God, stoke their hearts and their minds for things of you. God, we ask that you use this time mightily so that we can bless our congregation, and most of all, glorify and worship you and exalt the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. All right, Joe.
Yes.
So the big question. So last Friday, we went through the seven sayings of Jesus on the cross. And now this week, we celebrated the resurrection on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
So why is the tomb empty, Joe? Why is this significant? What is Jesus doing here? Why did he raise from the grave?
To put it plainly, because it was a promise.
Okay.
Right? The cross is only as effective as the resurrection is as real as it should be, right? So right. If Jesus died on the cross and there was no resurrection, then he'd be no different than any of the other people that were crucified and left on the cross for dead. There was something that had to happen. And the promise of redemption is through the power of the resurrection itself. So it's empty because Jesus is risen.
He is risen indeed. He is risen.
That's
so,
right.
So by rising from the dead, what is he proving to us? I mean, he said this is a promise, that he promised he would do this. He informed his disciples. He said, look, guys, this is what's going to happen. And he did it. But what does this prove to all believers about Jesus? What does this prove to them?
That's a good question, actually. What it proves is that when Jesus says that I am the way, the truth, and the life, that it proves that he is life. He's the source of all life. That the resurrection was so necessary in the redemption of mankind, in the restoration of man to God, that he fulfilled the promise that we would be like him, right? So eventually, even our bodies will be resurrected. So the Jews, there were two types of Jews, right? You had the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. I'm not going to say the corny joke, right?
No corny jokes.
No corny jokes. But the Pharisees did. But when they understood the resurrection, they understood the resurrection from the point that God, that the Messiah was going to come, and that the resurrection of the dead would happen because he was ushering in the kingdom, right? And then there would be judgment of those who weren't of the chosen. And the resurrection that God was really talking about was the redemption and resurrection of everyone for God, for those who accept Christ to eternal life in with him always, and for those who reject Christ to eternal punishment. So there's going to be a resurrection of everybody. Mm-hmm. Except he will separate the goats from the sheep, right? He's going to separate the believers from the non-believers. And he tells you where those believers are going to be with him and where those where the non-believers are going to be in eternal punishment apart from him. So the resurrection is crucial to all of the redemption story.
Well, crucial to the one fact that, you know, Jesus is God in the flesh.
Yes.
Jesus is the second person of the Trinity, mm-hmm. God in the flesh, and he's not just a prophet.
Correct.
So that's important, in basic apologetics, you know, defending our faith that Jesus is the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, and God in the flesh. So, you know, when we come up against other religions, you know, we were dealing with God on earth. Mm-hmm. We were being taught by God on earth. He was the one that was instructing us through the person of Jesus. It was more than just a great prophet that showed up and taught some really cool stuff and really useful information, or projecting some prophecies that did come true. He brought it all around. You know, like you said to me one time, he changed the entire game.
It was the whole thing. Changed everything. Because when you look at the reality of all the other men or prophets that other faiths worship or they follow, what's the difference between all of them and Jesus is that he's resurrected. All of history is documented on this one person, mm-hmm. Jesus Christ.
Right.
Right? Calendar. How even all the other religions look at him. They don't look at him as a bad guy. Mm-mm. They look at him as a good man. But the reality is they can't find his body. You can find where all the other prophets' bodies are. Those bones still exist, right? But Jesus is, no one can find it. And there's an important thing for that, right? And I think one of the things that we were talking about earlier was his face-to-face witness with the women, specifically Mary Magdalene.
Yeah. So yeah, let's get into that because this is really important. So in Mark, gotta put the glasses on for this one. So in Mark 16, 9 to 11, now when he rose early on the first day of the week, so he was crucified on Friday, he was resurrected on Sunday, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven demons. She went and told those that had been with him as they mourned and wept. And when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they did not believe. So they didn't believe. Why didn't they believe, Joe?
Well, there's also some more information that amazingly Luke gives us concerning the resurrection. So here's something interesting, a little factoid for you guys. The two men that actually talk about the eyewitness account of Jesus's resurrection out of the four gospels of the New Testament, two of them weren't even apostles. Right?
Mark,
which is the oldest New Testament book written, mm-hmm. right? Gospel written, and Luke, who was a physician, and he also wrote what?
Acts,
right?
Well, and you take Luke meticulously wrote his gospel. He researched, he interviewed, he did a lot
Absolutely.
Of things. You know, that it wasn't an eyewitness account, but it was a thorough account.
He was a reporter.
Yeah.
He went from person to person gathering information, meticulously documenting all that information down and then putting it together. It was like he was going out developing an autobiography of this guy.
Right.
Right. And so what was amazing is that Luke gives us a little bit more detail, and that's expected because Luke's a doctor.
Right.
Right. Doctors are into detail. So look, check out what Luke says in Luke 24. It says, now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain women with them came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they had prepared. Now, a lot of times people will read that and they'll go, well, the they have to be the disciples, but it wasn't.
No, it was the women.
It was the women. Go back to chapter 23. In chapter 23, in verse 55, it says, "And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to bring the spices which they had prepared. But they found that the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. It happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then as they were afraid, they bowed their faces to the earth and said, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise again.' And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and to the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other woman with them who told these things to the apostles. And their words seemed to them like idle tales, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves, and he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened." Now, when you go back to Mark, let's look what it says. When he arose early the first day of the week, he appeared to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast out seven demons. She went and told those who had been with him as they mourned and wept. And when they heard that he was alive, he had been seen by her, they did not believe. Isn't that interesting? So what you're seeing is this picture that Luke gives a lot more detail. And Mark specifically focuses on Mary. Why? Because one of the first miracles that Jesus did was he cast out demons, these demons of Mary Magdalene.
Yep.
And it was extremely uncommon for women to be eyewitnesses.
Right.
That's one of the reasons why they didn't believe. I mean, this is a woman. Why would Jesus appear to women? That's what made it believable.
So when you look at it, I mean, again, from an apologetic standpoint, that women back then were not considered credible witnesses.
That's correct.
So, you know, there was the whole, the Pharisees and those groups of people were saying, you know, well, if they steal the body, they'll create a hoax and say that he was the Messiah. But for them to step forward and say the first eyewitness accounts of the resurrected Christ were women, it is almost, it's flipping the script on them, because, you know, why would you, if you're going to set this up, you would have said, you know, we three men saw this happen, or, you know, they would bring forward what would be considered in those days a credible witness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, God, Jesus appeared to Mary Magdalene and the other women first, making a statement,
mm-hmm.
making a statement of there's no way in the world that you can really craft this other than that this is the facts of things.
Right. But let's look at it from an analytical. Let's say we're investigators, right?
We're
investigating a murder, right? So let's say if the majority of the people who were always associated with Jesus were men, and these men were the ones that the leaders of that day were saying would steal his body, why would Jesus appear to men and then men be the eyewitnesses? Because then they would be accused of stealing the body.
Yep.
But a woman can't carry a man's body out of a tomb. Now, those are some things I think we need to remember. These are women who went to prepare the body. Men typically weren't the preparers of the dead bodies. Women were. That's number one. Number two, Most women couldn't carry a body the size of Jesus. Jesus was not some skinny little white dude. Sorry if this offends you. Skinny little white dude that people would carry. This dude was strong. He walked on the average probably 30 to 40 miles a day. I mean, he was always walking every single, did it for 3 years. He wasn't some weakling, man. Like, this guy was fit, right? So after they did this and he appears to them, notice what Peter's response was. It says that Peter rose, right? But Peter arose and ran to the tomb. Why? Because Peter remembers. I honestly think that Peter like looked at Mary and go, if there's one person among us who we know was close with Jesus, who we know she's been with us from the beginning, Mary's not lying. So he's like, I got to go look for myself. And when he went, what happened?
So he went and he looked in. He saw the burial clothes raveled on the ground. And interestingly enough, the covering of his face was folded nice and neatly on the slab. So what was Jesus telling us there? I mean, I've always looked at that going, why didn't he fold the handkerchief? Why didn't he fold that piece and leave it and then everything else on the ground? So what are your thoughts on that? That's one of the...
Well, if somebody had stolen him, you're not going to fold anything.
If they were going to steal him, they would have taken everything.
They would have taken everything. Especially if they were Jews, because they couldn't touch the body. They would defile it. And Jews would not defile themselves. If they were really true, honest to goodness, Orthodox Jews, they aren't going to touch a dead body. You know, they have to wrap it. Now, the other thing you have to remember is they wouldn't touch the body until after it was completely decomposed and it was only bones. Then what would they do with the bones? They would take the bones and put them in a box.
In a box, yeah.
A stone white box. Jesus called them, he said to the Pharisees, you are whitewashed sepulchers. A sepulcher was a box that they would put the bones of the dead bodies in, because they didn't have enough tombs to hold everybody.
Right.
You know what I mean?
So
very important.
So, all right. So now we have Mary Magdalene is the first witness. She sees the resurrected Christ. And so she's weeping. She's sad. So if you go into, So in John 20, 11, 18. So this is a little long. So get comfortable, Joe.
No problem.
All right. Mary stood outside the tomb weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet. What does that sound like?
Right.
Go ahead. It sounds like the mercy seat, doesn't it?
Oh,
that sounds interesting.
That sounds interesting, yeah.
And where the body of Jesus was laying. And then he said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, because you've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. Now, when she said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, and did not know it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus then said to her, Mary. And she turned and said to him, Rabboni, which is to say teacher. Jesus said to her, do not cling to me, for I have not ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her. So what I did is the Rabboni. So this is the first time I can remember reading in scripture the word Rabboni. So I looked it up. So I and what it means is it's a combo word. It's Lord and teacher in one. So it's an extra. It's a term of great reverence.
Mm-hmm.
So when I first read it, I was like, it was more of like an affectionate name. But no, it's a term of great reference, meaning Lord and teacher.
Right.
And what a great word to describe our Lord Jesus Christ. Rabboni, Lord teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's our God, but he's been here and he's taught us so much about everything, about life. And just, I was it was blessed me when I looked it up when it said that. So
yeah. So the word Lord also means master. Mm. So there were those who were like teachers, and then there's those who are master teachers, right? He is the teacher of teachers. It's very interesting. She uses that. It's sort of like the Jedi versus Padawan.
Right. So you're going to look here is why did she not recognize him at first?
Yeah.
Okay. You remember, she has been crying.
Okay.
She's been crying for days. She was looking down. So she, you know, she, you know, may not have seen him fully. She may not have looked up. She, you know, there's a lot of different reasons here where she may not have recognized him. But Jesus fulfilled a little prophecy here, his prophecy.
Which is?
When I speak, the sheep, my sheep will hear me and they will. And
they will know my voice, right?
Yes.
That's right. What's interesting, though, is he's in his glorified state at this point.
Right. And that's and something we have to talk about a lot.
He hasn't ascended to the Father yet, right? This is important because what he's saying is I haven't gone to the Father yet. And then later on, he does come and meet the other disciples. So one of the reasons why she didn't really recognize him is because she didn't recognize him in his new state.
Okay, so let's talk about this for a second. Uh-huh. Because everybody, one, the last time she saw Jesus is when they were pulling him down on the cross and preparing his body for burial.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus was not in very good shape.
No.
Okay, so we talked about that the last time. In critical condition, by the time he had died, I mean, just a wreck.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't just, you know, that body was what resurrected. It was a glorified body. It was a completely healed and restored body, with the exception of the nail holes and the hole in his side. You know, the scars of his death.
Right.
He was completely restored and glorified. Now, we talk about glorified. So let's talk about human interactions with glorified bodies.
Okay.
So angels. So we can go back to the shepherds when the angels, you know, the angels appeared to them at the birth of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And they were sore afraid. So they were overwhelmed by these heavenly beings. So our bodies, our minds, our eyes are very sensitive to heavenly things.
They are. And I think when Mary thinks he's the gardener, because obviously he doesn't really look the same. But all of a sudden, as you had said earlier, he says to her, Mary, and she says, Rabboni. Because there's one thing that we know that Mary knows more than anything. Mary knows her name, right? Number one. Number two, Mary knows how Jesus has always said her name. Mm-hmm. So when he says Mary, she's like, that's my teacher. Rabboni, right? Teacher. So he calls her by name, just like he does you and I.
Yes.
So you are right on the money, Mike. When he uses that term, he's using it because he knows that Mary will know his voice, because she is the sheep of his pen. She is one of his. And she recognizes that voice and she immediately says, Rabboni, right? So I want you to get that. It's an important relational point there, is that intimacy between the shepherd and the sheep, mm-hmm, is so important, right? Now, what's interesting in this whole discussion about this moment is that this is, in three different books, a connection to Mary Magdalene. I want you to get that. The first, I think, is most impressive, is that Mary was mentioned among all the other women who went there early in the morning to take care of the body and make sure it was well preserved, mm-hmm, right? The second is Mark, right? Mark mentions her and her condition so that you know clearly who this Mary is, Mary Magdalene, the woman who had seven demons. And then John gets into a lot more relational conversation about Mary, mm-hmm, and her relationship with Jesus specifically. This is a key eyewitness. I want you to understand this in the resurrection, because we're gonna be getting further down the road talking about how he appeared to the men on the road to Emmaus, how he appeared to the apostles in the room, how he also appeared to Thomas who doubted, and they say, stick your hand in there, right? How he also appeared in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it says that he appeared to 500 different people. But there's one specific out of all the appearances that is mentioned more than anyone else, Mary Magdalene. Think about that. The reason why is because she was so demon-possessed, she was so radically changed that everybody who knew her and knew her lifestyle at that time knew she was changed. She was a key eyewitness because of her testimony. That's one of the reasons I believe that Peter got up, ran to the tomb, and saw for himself that she was right.
You just brought something up, I never really thought about this, is out of the 12 plus Mary Magdalene, I don't think he healed any of the other disciples besides her.
Yeah.
I mean, the apostle, the 12 apostles.
Yeah.
So, I mean, and another thing is, it's like in Jesus's ministry, you know, you think it's just 12 guys and Mary following Jesus,
mm-hmm.
but he drew a crowd. It wasn't, you know, towards the end there, I mean, there were more and more disciples besides the apostles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you think about, I mean, Stephen and Matthias and these guys were all around there already.
Mm-hmm.
They had, you know, they had interactions with Jesus prior to coming to him. So they were pre-crucifixion Christians, mm-hmm. so to speak. So there were more than just the 12. There were more than just Mary Magdalene at this point. There were many followers of Jesus.
Yeah.
We don't know how many.
Yeah.
But you can see through, you know, it's not like they went and grabbed Matthias off the street and said, hey, do you want to be an apostle? It was, he was one of the other guys that was already around.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there was a core following of the church.
Yeah. And there were four specific women mentioned more than any of the other women mm-hmm. in all of the New Testament, especially within the four gospels, right? You have Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of Jesus, right. Martha, and Martha's sister, Mary. So we're three Marys and Martha,
Marys.
Right? And so what's amazing is out of all those women, she was the one that was most impacted. Now, that doesn't mean that Martha or Mary wasn't impacted. They saw their brother raised from the dead. I mean, so they knew that he was the resurrection. You know, I can't help but maybe think that there was a possibility that once Mary said what she said, because she was there watching Lazarus come out of the tomb, right? That they realized, Peter realized, wait a minute, if he resurrected Lazarus from the dead, I gotta go check this out for myself. I'm just saying, I'm being a person who kind of thinks outside of the box, and I definitely don't want to encourage you or any of us, right, to get into the mode of being a sensationalizing scripture. That's not the point. But let's think about the human aspect of what they were thinking, going through, and what they experienced when they were walking with him.
Right.
There had to be something in Peter's mind that triggered, I need to see for myself.
Yeah, and that's a good disclosure. So, I mean, what we're doing is we're commenting on our thoughts on scripture.
Yes.
So, unless it's exactly the way it's read out of the Bible. Now, Joe and I are working with two different translations. I got New King James and you have...
ESV.
Okay. So, when we read it out of the Bible, that's fact. It's undisputed fact. If it's in the Bible, it is the Word of God, it is canon, it is fact. When we start expressing our opinions,
yep.
it's commentary.
Commentary.
It's our thought. It's, you know, maybe some things that we've gathered through, you know, through just, you know, prayer and meditating on the Word. But we always encourage you to read the scriptures.
Be a good Berean.
Yes.
Yep.
Read the scriptures. Let it soak into you. Let it, you know, study the Bible. I mean, the scriptures tell us we have to study.
Yep.
You know, and some of us learn different than others, and that's okay. I like to read a lot sometimes, and sometimes I want to read a few verses and let it really soak in. So, I mean, just try a different ways and just, but I want to highly encourage you to pick up your Bibles, especially now. We have more time on our hands. Let's be honest. There's more time in our days. Even if you're still working 8 hours, you don't have a commute anymore. You know, a lot of us have more time to do these things. So make this a season for really digging in and reading the scriptures and praying hard and getting to a really, really stronger relationship with God.
Absolutely. So I want to encourage you, as you spend time, and we ask questions, and we want to be able to relate to these men and these women who are old, right? These guys that God, that Jesus used to really start to build the beginning of the church, right? And so it's important that we also remember that they're human, that we're able to connect with them, that we can also think through some things. Paul actually challenges us. It says, let us sit down and reason together the scriptures, right? So we're not asking you to do anything else outside of that, but we're asking you is to think. Spend time thinking through, asking questions, study the word, stick with specifically with what the word says, right? The scripture is the final authority among everything else. But we can also enjoy some speculation so that we can see some type of relational connection with the other brothers and sisters in Christ who lived in those days. Like, I know, for me, that's kind of interesting. Like, the way they would think about things or what they experienced or the pains they felt, you know, that they felt lonely or abandoned, or they felt happy and joyful, and they laughed and they giggled. And so I want to encourage you, as you spend time in the Word, stick specifically with the scripture, as Mike said, but then also be able to think through the process of, if I was one of them, how would I experience that, right? But be careful. Be a good steward of the Word of God and stick with the Word and hold to the Word, and you won't go wrong. Okay. Now, I know next week, are we going to be talking about the road to Emmaus next week, or what's our next?
So, yeah, road to Emmaus next week. And let me see. We got road to Emmaus and the first encounter with Peter and the apostles in Jerusalem.
Okay, in the room when they were locked in.
Wow, that's that.
That's where Jesus literally like pops in, doesn't open a door, appears, and then he like totally disappears. Like, that would freak me
Rejoice.
Out, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, those are strange times for those guys.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, they had their Lord, their leader, their teacher ripped from them. And, you know, several of them watched him die.
Yeah.
Now we've got an empty grave. And they're processing.
Yeah.
Remember, these are earthly people, man. These are not, these aren't angels. They're human beings just like all of us.
Yeah.
Think about this type of event in your life and having to mentally and emotionally and spiritually process that. That's a lot of overload there.
Yeah, the first thing that pops out of their mouth, just like it probably would pop out of me and yours, right? Is that a ghost? Like, what is that, right? Like, I'm about to run and jump. I mean, if I ever got stuck in a haunted house and something spoke to me or somebody popped up out of nowhere, I'm out, right? So, but that's what we're going to be talking about over these next couple weeks. So please stay tuned. Come back to the living room next week. We want to thank you. And as we close, we're going to pray.
Yep.
You want me to pray? Do you want
you
to pray?
You pray. I pray in. You pray out.
All right. Awesome.
All right, there we go.
Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the reminder of the importance of your relationship with Mary and how the women became a crucial testimony of your resurrection to the apostles. Thank you for the words that you've given, which you've shown us in the word, and the simplicity of really the resurrection that you resurrected so that we will have victory over death, that we will resurrect with you. It's a promise that you have made and have fulfilled. And so, look, Lord, I want to thank you. You are the resurrection and the life. And to you be all honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. See you later.
See you guys.